Good morning. Welcome to everyone. A very, very special welcome to those of you who are guests with us today. We're very happy that you could join us as we worship our Lord this morning. We're continuing our post-Easter sermon series that's called Victory of the Lamb. And today we'll talk about the fact that He is worthy. He is worthy of us giving Him praise, glory, and honor. We'll follow the order of service that you find on the screens, and it's also provided for you in the service folder. Before we get started, I ask that you would stand, and as you feel comfortable, say good morning to those around you today. If you would, please be seated. And let's give our attention to the preschool and kindergarten children. They'll share with us the song, I'll Live for Him. It is time for the children's message, and any other children who are here this morning are welcome to come down. I wanted to say to you guys, that was awesome. That was wonderful. So thank you very, very much for singing that song today. Thank you. Okay, everybody, wave to your mom and dad and grandma and grandpa, because I know you want to do that. There you go. Moms and dads and grandpas can wave back. I want to show you a finger play that I learned when I was your age. And it goes like this. You put your hands like this, okay? And you go, here's the church. Then you put your fingers up like that and say, here's the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. So here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. Now, I want to talk about the people that are in church. And the people are you guys and everybody else here. We are the people in the church. I want to talk to you about why we come to this place as the church. And there's really two reasons, and it's simple to understand. One is to get something, and the other is to give something. When we come here, we get something. God speaks to us through His Word in the Bible. And when He does that, He strengthens our faith and trust in Him, and He teaches us how to live our lives the way He wants us to. So we get something when we learn from God's Word. We're also here, though, to give. We're to give our thanks and praise to God because He is our Savior from sin. We give our thanks and praise to God because He's the one who's given us everything that we have and enjoy in life. We give our thanks and praise to God for making us, taking care of us, and saving us. And we do that with our songs, just like you guys did. We do it with our songs, we do it with our prayers, and we do it with our words. So always remember that when we come to church, we're here to get something and to give something. To get strength and encouragement from God's Word and teaching, and then to give our thanks and praise to God. So let's ask Jesus now in prayer to help us remember that. Dear Lord, we thank You that You've made us members of Your family, which we call the church. And You want us to gather together. And as we do, it gives us a chance to get something from You, to hear and listen to Your Word and to grow in faith and to learn. And it also gives us a chance to give You the honor and glory and praise You deserve. So help us keep that in mind every time we come to church. It's wonderful to have that opportunity to get and to give. We pray this in Your name, Jesus. Amen. You guys can go back to your seats.
I ask that you please stand and join us on the first song. Thank you.
may be seated. Please join me in the responsive invocation and confession of sin. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever. Amen.
I was lost, I was blind,
The first scripture lesson today is Peter's first letter, chapter 1, beginning with verse 17. Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Our gospel lesson is Luke chapter 24, beginning with verse 13. This is the historic account of Jesus meeting disciples on the road to Emmaus after his resurrection from the dead. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. What is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This concludes our scripture readings for today. We'll continue with the next song, "Is He Worthy?"
Just a note about this song. It's directly based off of the scripture reading that Pastor is going to be reading later, Revelation chapter 5. Also, we ask that you respond with the bolded words. Do you feel the world is broken? We do. Do you feel
The message today is based on the revelation that our Lord Jesus gave to the Apostle John, chapter 5. John writes this: "Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?' But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw a lamb, looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. The lamb had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of God's people. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth." Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice, they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." The four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will show forth your praise. Amen. The Revelation is my favorite book in the Bible. But we have to understand some things about the Revelation so we understand it correctly. First of all, the Revelation is apocalyptic literature. It's a vision, which means we don't understand it literally as if we're reading some history book, but rather we understand things as being symbolic, including the numbers. And we understand the numbers based on what the scriptures talk about concerning the numbers. And that's something else to keep in mind. For us to properly understand the Revelation, we have to go back and look to the clear portions of God's word that talk about the New Testament times in which we are living now and about the second coming of Jesus. The purpose of the Revelation is twofold. One, it serves as a warning. As a warning to those who do not believe in Jesus as their Savior. And the warning is this: if you don't believe, you will experience eternal consequences, damning consequences in hell. The second purpose is to encourage us who are the believers. As we look around in the world today, it seems like everything's nuts. It's chaos in this world. And we wonder if Jesus really is in control of all things. And the Revelation tells us that even all this craziness is going on, he is still in control because he has won the victory for us over our spiritual enemies. And he did it 2,000 years ago on the cross. And his resurrection proves it, because if he had not won the victory over our spiritual enemies, he'd be dead today, but he's not. And he's alive. And that's why you and I can be absolutely confident that even though this world seems like it's nuts, our Lord Jesus controls everything in the universe and in our lives for the benefit of, for us and of the church and of his kingdom. And we will experience eternity with our Lord someday in heaven. And that's guaranteed. That is the message of the Revelation. In chapter 5, there's a couple of things, too, we need to talk about before we go on. First of all, the Lamb. The Lamb is Jesus. John the Baptist called Jesus the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. In our epistle reading today, Jesus is called the Lamb. In the Old Testament, a lamb was sacrificed to atone for the sins of people. And Jesus is the Lamb that God sent into the world. And he sacrificed his life. He shed his blood to atone for your sins and my sins and the sins of the entire human race. There's also a couple of numbers in chapter 5. There's the number 4, which is the number of creation. The 4 winds, the 4 corners, the 4 directions. 4 is the number of creation. That's the 4 elders. The 4 beasts, the 4 creatures. And then we have the number 7. 7 is a compilation of the number 3 and 4. 3 is the number of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. 4 is the number of creation. Put them together, you got 7. And so 7 symbolizes God interacting with his creation and with mankind. And then you have the number 24, which is a compilation of the number 12. 12 plus 12. 12 is the number of the church. 12 is the number of the believers. 12 tribes of Israel, 12 apostles, Old Testament, New Testament church, put them together, you got 24. So it's the whole church that was standing around and singing this new song, Worthy is the Lamb, to receive glory and honor and praise. The Lamb is worthy. He is worthy to take up his full power and glory as Lord again. For Jesus to do his saving work, he had to go through what we call his humiliation. And his humiliation started from the time he was conceived in the Virgin Mary until his burial. During that time, Jesus set aside his full power and glory as Lord of all. And he did it to become one of us and do what had to be done to save us. If he had come into our world with all of his glory, all of his power, there's no way anybody would have arrested him and crucified him. So he had to set that aside. Even though it still belonged to him, he set it aside for a while. And he accomplished his saving work. His resurrection verifies it, as we talked about again. And now Jesus is in his exaltation. From the moment he came to life into eternity, Jesus has taken up his full power and glory again as Lord of all. And he is reigning over this creation and this universe. And will reign for eternity. That's why he is worthy. He is worthy not only to take up his full power and glory again, he is worthy to take up his perfect wisdom. And he is deserving of our and creation's praise, glory, and honor. He is worthy, as verse 9 says, to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You and I are in Revelation 5. We are part of this crowd of believers in heaven who sing this new song, Worthy is the Lamb. But we can also express the same thought, Worthy is the Lamb, in how we live our lives. And so we'll talk about that for a few minutes. We say and we show Worthy is the Lamb when we give him our minds. Give him our minds. When God the Holy Spirit gave us faith in Jesus Christ, we're told that he transformed our thinking. The way we think by nature is to look through the lens of self. But now as believers, we don't look through the lens of self anymore, but we look through the lens of God. It's what God wants, what God desires. That's what we want. That's what we desire. And when it comes to our logic and reason, there are many things about God and what the Bible teaches that we can't comprehend. But our logic and reason is limited and it's weak. And so we must subject our reason and logic, our minds, to the Word and to the will of God. When we do that, when we give Him our minds, we are saying and expressing, "Worthy is the Lamb." We do the same when we give Jesus our hearts. We are to love Him. We are to love Him because of the love He has expressed to us. We are to love Him above anyone or anything else in life, even ourselves. We are to love others as God wants us to love, the way He loves us, to love others with no conditions and no limits and a willingness to sacrifice self, even to love somebody who may not be very lovable. We give of our hearts when we love His Word, because we know in His Word we find salvation for our souls. We are to love His commandments because we know that God gave His commandments to love because He loves us. And His intention is that when we follow His commands, He wants to bless us. And it glorifies Him as well. And we are to express our hearts to God and love God in our repentance. When we sin, our sin hurts God. But we don't want to hurt God. And so we go to Him and we say we're sorry. And we confess our sin. And he says to us again, "You have my forgiveness because of what the Lamb has done." And now we have an opportunity and the motivation to strive not to sin and to live our lives in a way that pleases and glorifies God, because it's a way for us to love Him. So when we give our hearts to Jesus, we are saying and expressing, "Worthy is the Lamb." Also, we do so when we give Him our trust. Now, we trust and believe in Jesus as our Creator and our Savior, but in addition to that, we are to trust His teachings, because His teachings are perfect and pure. We are to trust His will and His wisdom, because His will and His wisdom is also perfect and pure. We are to trust His power and His strength. We are to trust His timing as He interacts in our world and in our lives. We are to trust the promises He makes to us and the outcomes of those promises and the outcomes of how He interacts in our lives. We are to trust His love. Now, in our weakness, we sometimes don't trust. We don't trust the will of God. We don't trust the wisdom of God. We don't trust His power and strength. We don't trust His timing, and we question the outcomes that He brings into our lives, and we are in no position to do that because we are weak and imperfect. But He is not. He is perfect and powerful, and He says, "Trust me." When we give Him our trust, we are saying and showing, "Worthy is the Lamb." Then finally, we do so by giving Him our bodies, who we are and what we have. We show Him to be worthy when we bring ourselves to this place to worship Him, to sit here and listen to what He says to us. And He speaks to each of us and to our hearts as we hear His word, and he nourishes our faith. We sit here together and we commune with Him as He comes to us in a real way through the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And He comes to us personally to tell us again that we're forgiven and that we're loved. When we come together here, we have the chance to do what we've been doing today, which is to give the Lamb the praise and glory and honor that He deserves, as I said with the kids, with our words, with our prayers, and with our songs. When we come and worship Him, we are saying, "Worthy is the Lamb." Along with that, God would have us give back to Him of our resources. We're told in the Revelation that all wealth belongs to him. And so everything that you and I have doesn't belong to us. It belongs to God. And he wants us to give back some of it for the work of his church. And as we do that, he wants us to sit down and think about it and plan our giving. He wants us to give to him first before doing anything else with the resources we have. He wants us to give cheerfully because it's a way for us, in a very practical way, to say thank you and express our gratitude to him. And he wants us to give generously, understanding that he's given us a promise that he'll make it possible for us to be generous in giving back to him and helping other people. And then there are our abilities and our time. When we give of our abilities and time, we are saying, worthy is the Lamb. Many, many of you are doing this, and I just encourage you to keep on doing it. But if we're not, we got to figure this out. We have to understand how God has made us and who we are, what we got, and look for ways, actively look for ways, to use who we are to serve him and to serve other people. By giving Jesus our minds, by giving him our hearts, by giving him our trust, and by giving him our bodies and all that we have, we are saying and showing, worthy is the Lamb. The point of chapter 5 is for us to always focus on the Lamb and what he's done for us. We must always focus on the sacrifice he made for us. A sacrifice that is something we don't deserve, a sacrifice that is still incomprehensible to us, a sacrifice that brings us relief because we know through that sacrifice we're at peace with God and eternal life is ours, a sacrifice that fills us with confidence and with peace. Worthy is the Lamb. So how are we, as we live our lives, expressing that and showing that? What can we do with who we are, what we have, to show worthy is the Lamb? What changes and adjustments need to be made in our lives so we can do what the Lamb is worthy of, to give him glory and honor and praise? Let's actively participate in doing what we can to say, worthy is the Lamb, and to join all creation and all believers in singing this song, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Let's stand for prayer. Lord, we bring before you Jan and Jean Blumke, who are celebrating their 55th wedding anniversary. We join them in thanking you for all the blessings you've given to them over their 55 years of marriage, especially the shared faith they have in you. We ask that you would continue to bless them in the future, as you have certainly done in the past. We also pray for Shelley Krumschroeder. We have called Shelley to be a seventh grade teacher in our Christian day school. Lord, you are the Lord of the church, and we ask that you would be with Shelley as she contemplates not only the call she is serving in Greenfield, Minnesota at this time, but the call we've extended to her. We know that you will move her to make a decision that is pleasing to you and is beneficial for your kingdom. We also pray for Jody Mitzner. Jody is the sister-in-law of our member Kay Mitzner, and Jody is near death and entering eternal life. Pray, Lord, that you would be with Jody, help her to focus on the cross, help her to focus on the Lamb and the sacrifice he has made for her, and bring her from this life to eternal life with you. We ask that you would be not only with Jody, but Kay and the entire family at this time, and give them the comfort only you can give. We also pray for Joni Gorowski, who is 10 months old. Joni is cancer-free, and Lord, we thank and praise you for that, but she is dealing with some infections as well. And so it's our prayer, Lord, that you would not only help her remain cancer-free, but drive the infections from her body and restore her to health. Then finally, Lord, we pray for Bill Schrader. This week, Bill will be undergoing heart surgery. We ask that you would be with him and those who are performing the procedure, and that everything may go well. We pray that you would bring strength and healing to his body. These things we bring before you in Jesus' name, and now we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. It is certainly right for us to give back to the Lamb who has sacrificed so much for us with an offering. If you brought your offering with you today, you can place it in the baskets as you leave. You can also make an offering by mail, online, or using the QR code or the text phone number that you find in the service folder. God has strengthened and nourished our faith through his word today, so let's confess that faith. Let's speak together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Receive with a believing heart the blessing of our Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen.
Thank you.
You may be seated. And again, a very good morning and welcome to all of you here. We ask that if you have opportunity to sign the friendship folder that you find at the end of your row. Our thanks to our musicians and all those who are involved in our worship service today. We truly are grateful for your gifts and talents as we give glory, praise, and honor in saying, "Worthy is the Lamb," in our worship. Also, thank you to the children who sang this morning. As I said to you, it was awesome and it was wonderful. Also, very helpful in giving glory, honor, and praise to our Lord Jesus. A couple of quick announcements. Grad photos for our high school and college students are due today. The in-season and out-of-season outreach Bible study is this Thursday at Living Hope, beginning at 6:30. Come and check it out. Also, come to Bloomington Lutheran School this Thursday at either 2 or 7 and see the 5th through 8th grade school play called I Need a Vacation. I Need a Vacation. Free will offering today for the Forward in Christ magazines and the meditation devotion books that we enjoy. You'll find an offering box on the table as you leave, as this offering helps offset the cost for these publications. Then I invite Lily Hollander to come forward. Lily is a student at West Lutheran High School, and she and others are going to be taking a mission trip to Utah. And so first we'll take a look at a video, and then Lily will say a few words to us. So if we can watch that video.
Hello, I am Pastor Mark Kaysmeyer, Director of Mission Advancement at West Lutheran High School, and privileged to be part of the chaperone team for the West Lutheran High School Warrior Mission.
Don't you love technology? Is it going to work? Oh.
Hello, I am Pastor Mark Kaysmeyer, Director of Mission Advancement at West Lutheran High School, and privileged to be part of the chaperone team for the West Lutheran High School Warrior Mission Trip.
My name is Ashley Jensen. I'm a teacher and coach here at West Lutheran. I also help with a lot of areas where I get to work with students outside of the classroom. It's a privilege to get to see students use those gifts outside of the classroom, and a way we get to do that is through this mission trip. And so this year we are going to Logan, Utah, which is about an hour north of Salt Lake City. The dates this year are going to be June 3rd through the 10th.
The goals of our trip is really threefold. First of all, we want to help Truth in Love as they reach out to a group of people that desperately need to know about Jesus. A second goal is to help the entire team, that's Ashley and myself included, to grow in our ability to witness and really grow in faith. And as you do that, it's often very stressful, so to enjoy a beautiful part of God's creation is also something the whole team enjoys.
We're very much both looking forward to growing in our faith, like he mentioned, and with the students. And we get to take 9 students with us this year. Half of those students came on the trip last year, and then we have a decent amount of new ones as well. So with that, we'd love for you to meet that mission trip team.
Hi, I'm Allison. I'm a junior here at West, and I'm really looking forward to this trip because I'm planning on going into the public ministry, and sharing my faith has always been a really big thing to me. And I feel like this is the next big step in my faith. I'm super excited because all of the people that I'm going on the trip with are some of my greatest friends. And I'm super excited to just help more people get to know Jesus.
Hi, my name is Tan. I'm in 10th grade. I went on this trip last year, and probably one of my favorite parts of it was being able to just see like the spiritual growth in like people when you're going to doors, and just being able to like see a different point of view than yours. And I liked the hiking. That was really fun. It was nice to be able to like do some other things and get to be in a different environment. Since I went last year, I'm excited to be able to help like people who are new to the trip get to experience it and just help them like get it down.
Hi, I'm Elise. I'm a senior, and I am really excited to go on this mission trip. I'm most excited about getting to share the hope that we have alongside fellow believers, get to spend time with the friends I'm going with, and explore Utah.
Hello, My name is Evan Murphy, and I'm a freshman here at West Lutheran High School. I'm excited to spread the gift of God's Word and to see Utah.
Hi, I'm Mary, and I'm a junior here at West Lutheran. I'm excited for the Utah mission trip to be able to show my faith and to grow my faith and to see other people who are strong in their faith and want to show it to others also. I'm also excited to go to Utah and see the Zion National Park.
Hi, I'm Lydia. I'm a sophomore here at West. I really am excited to go on the trip this year because last year I went, and my favorite part about it was that I got to learn skills to help me share my faith every day, which is really important. And also I strengthened a lot of the friendships that I had, and I got to go on the tallest zip line in North America, which was really, really fun.
Here comes Lydia!
You screamed the whole way.
I know!
What's your review of the extreme zipline?
Well, it was the best experience of my whole entire life. It's 11 out of 10, and I would do it again. It was so fun. Oh my gosh.
Hi, I'm Jacob. I'm a senior in high school, and I'm going to Utah because a lot of my friends convinced me to go. And I'm really excited, and I'm looking forward to being able to see Utah, climb some of the mountains, and of course, getting an opportunity to share my faith with others.
Hi, my name is Lily Hollander. I'm a junior here at West Lutheran High School. And I'm excited for Utah this year. I'm a returnee, so I get to go back, and I'm really excited to be able to share my faith again because last year, with sharing my faith, I was also able to grow in my faith. And I'm also super excited for all the hiking again. This year we get to go to Zion, and I'm super excited to be able to go to some national parks.
Hi, I'm Olivia. I'm a West Lutheran alumni and a freshman at UW River Falls. I got to go on the Utah mission trip last year, and it was an absolutely amazing experience. I loved being out in nature and being able to share my faith and meet people at the door and talk to them about their faith while also being out in God's beautiful creation in Utah. I'm really looking forward to being able to do that again and with some new people as well and be able to strengthen my faith and go door to door and share God's amazing love with other people who really need to hear it.
As you can see, the team is very excited to head out west this summer. We're hoping that we can find the financial support to do that. So your prayers and your offerings is going to help us do that. Check out some of the links below that will share that information.
And continue to stay tuned with our social media pages through West Lutheran High School to kind of see what's going on with the team. And thank you again for any support you offer.
Thanks. Have a great spring.
So I'll try to keep it short since the video was a little longer, but just to summarize and reiterate what the video said, the main goal of this mission trip is to bring God's love to those of a community who are lost and don't know God's true love. So if you feel so inclined to, we would love for you to donate at the link that you see, or really just supporting us with your prayers would be helpful as well. Thank you.
So that's givebutter.com/WestMission23. And there's also a QR code on the table as you leave today. Thank you. I think that's it. May God grant you a wonderful week until we meet to worship our Lord again.